Hey everyone, this is Prithvi. This is the continuation of my first video. For those who haven't watched the first video, you can just check the link in the description. The second thing, if you have a background of strength of materials, you'll understand this video much better. So with that, I'll just briefly summarize what I did in my previous video. We performed two experiments. In the first experiment, I broke a chalk piece in tension and we observed that the failure plane was perpendicular to the loading axis. And in the second experiment, I broke the chalk in torsion and we observed that the failure plane was inclined at 45 degrees to the loading axis. And the question that I left was, how can we explain this? So the short answer is using failure theories, but we need to understand other concepts in fair amount of detail to approach this. So my idea is to start with the loading states, which we have now, and I'll explain what is a stress state in a very simple way, and we'll derive the stress state for one of the cases, and I'll give insights into what are principal planes and stresses and why do we need to care about this. Then I'll briefly explain about the Mohr circle, and finally we'll go to the explanation of failure theories and answering the question. All right, let me explain the stress state in a simple way. Most of the solid mechanics problems, including these two examples that I have shown here, are in a state of quasi-static equilibrium, which means the net force and the net moment are zero. It also implies one more important thing, which is any subpart will be in equilibrium, which means say if I take two subparts, both are of different shapes, and you isolate them along with the forces and moments, each of these subparts will be in equilibrium. Let's exploit this to obtain the state of stress. And this is the 2D representation of a chalk loaded in tension. And if I do an imaginary cut here, and let's analyze the top portion of this. And for this to be in equilibrium, we need a force at the bottom face. And this force F could be considered as the internal resistance offered by the entire cross section to the external load. Let's go a bit further and consider the internal resistance of each and every point in the cross section, and that's where we get the notion of stress, and that would be like, in this case it will be F by A, and see that we have gone from force to stress in this case. And let's make a cut here and again do the same thing. We'll subject that to equilibrium, we'll get the stresses on both faces. And let me again do a two vertical cuts here, and we'll get the subpart which is also in equilibrium, and these two faces doesn't have any stresses, right? So could you explain why? And try to do this till I reach a point which I'll represent it as a small square, say of the order of 10 power minus 6 meters. There is a significance for this number. If you just happen to know that, just comment it out. And this is what we obtain for a point. So we started from the force equilibrium of a structure, and all the way we went up to the stress equilibrium of a single point. And this is what we call as a stress state. Let me loosely define the stress state. It will be the free body diagram in terms of stresses at a point, and the stress state gives the nature and magnitude of stresses at a point. So for a 3D case, a point could be represented as a cube, and a generalized stress state will look like this. The stress components that are perpendicular to the plane are known as the normal stresses, and whatever the parallel to the plane are known as the shear stresses. Let me put down the general cases, and the first case I have already explained it in sufficient detail, and for the next two cases I'll ask you to derive it using the equilibrium method, and I'll just show you what we obtain. So for the torsion, we obtain a state of pure shear, and for bending, if you take point A, which is above the axis, it will be in tension, and if you take to the other side of the axis, that will be in compression. With that, I'll ask you one more question. If a structure is subjected to all forces like axial, bending moment and torsion, what do you think the stress state will be? A small hint will be use the superposition. While deriving the stress state, I referred a point to be a square. You may come and argue that why not we take shapes like this. The short answer is these things make the math very messier. Hence, we will stick to the square. And of course, in 3D, it would be a cube. From now on, if I refer to a square, it means that actually I am referring to a point. Just keep this in mind for the forthcoming slides. By that, we actually have completed the stress state, and I'll be now discussing the principal planes and principal stresses. Let's consider the structure loaded in tension. While deriving the stress state, I took the square whose edges were parallel to the edges of the structure. We can actually take squares like these two, right, which are rotated in some sense. And depending on the rotation of these squares, we have infinite possibilities. And one more important point is that all these rotated squares refer to the same point. Let's analyze this in more detail. As I said, there are infinite possibilities. The first question is, how do we distinguish them? Like we have names or nicknames, right? So we use the local coordinate system. We associate each square with a coordinate system like this, and each has a distinct coordinate system. Also, you may observe that the axis are perpendicular to the respective faces in all of these cases. So I talked about the rotated squares and coordinate systems. And the next question is, how do we measure the rotation? For this, we take the fixed coordinate system, which is this, and we can actually refer to any local coordinate system with respect to an angle theta. And for instance, the first case, if you put theta equal to 0, you'll get this coordinate system. If you make theta equal to 15, you'll get this coordinate system. And if you make theta equal to 45, you'll actually obtain this coordinate system. The most important question is, how about the stress states? In these cases, are they same or different? Let's find it out. So for this case, I have already derived the stress state. This will be just the normal stresses. And for this case, I do not know. Let's seek the help of the equilibrium method. Let's go back and I'll do an imaginary cut here and enforce the equilibrium. So we'll have a force here. The next step, I'll resolve this force into normal and tangential components. I'll stop here and I'll give you a quick pointer. You see, there is actually a shear force here, which means we'll get shear stresses in this stress state. So this would be enough to say that these two are different stress states. And I would like to emphasize that the stress state depends on the choice of the coordinate system. To make the point stronger, let us do a simple example. Consider the tension case with a force of 1 unit and an area of 1 unit. And I tabulated the stress states with respect to 4 different coordinate systems at different angles. And all that I wanted you to see is they have different stress states. You may pass this and just go into detailed analysis. But let me re-emphasize the point. The stress state depends on the choice of the coordinate system. With all that background, we are now ready to define the principal stresses. We have seen that there are infinite possible coordinate systems, and each of them may have distinct stress states. And there will be one particular coordinate system about which the stress state would only be composed of normal stresses. In other words, the shear stresses will be zero. For the structure loaded in tension, we have seen that this occurs at theta equal to zero. And the stress state was composed of only normal stresses. And the corresponding planes, which are these two, perpendicular to the x and y axis, are known as the principal planes. And the corresponding stresses, which are, it is 0 here, which is trivial, and corresponding to this plane it is sigma. So the 0, sigma are known as the principal stresses. So giving a quick summary, we found that one coordinate system which had zero shear stresses, and from that we defined what are known as the principal planes, and from that we went to the definition of the principal stresses. Let's look into the torsion case, and we know the stress state for this, which is of pure shear. And now the question is, how about the principal stresses and planes? How do we find them, and what are the stress states at a particular coordinate system which is at an angle theta? So I don't want to go back to the equilibrium method because I'm very tired. Also, you may be, it's time consuming, right? So is there a simpler method? Fortunately, there is something known as the Mohr circle method, which is very simple. That's what we'll be discussing next. I'm not going to explain this in detail like I did for stress state or principal stresses. I shall go through this very quickly with fewer insights. If you plot all these stress states at a point, you will obtain a circle which is called as the Mohr circle. And a question for you, why do you obtain a circle and not an ellipse or something else? Just think about it. We can also understand this as a simple graphical representation from which we can obtain the stress states. This is generally used for calculation of the principal stresses and corresponding planes, maximum shear stress and the corresponding plane. To construct a Mohr circle, you need stress values at two perpendicular planes. With that, let's go and look at the tensile case. This explanation is very self-explanatory, so you may pass this and glance at it. And we get the Mohr circle for the tensile case like this. Also, the construction of the Mohr circle is simple, so I am skipping it, but let me give you some insights. The horizontal axis corresponds to tau equal to zero line, so it is called as the principal stress line, and the vertical axis corresponds to sigma equal to zero, and this is called as the line of pure shear. And if you see from the graph, you know that B holds the maximum principal stress value and some point here holds the maximum shear stress value. And if you see, AB gives the stress state at theta equal to zero, and A being this plane and B being this plane. Now let's find out the stress state at an angle 45 degree. To do this, we need to rotate AB by 90 degree. Yes, you heard me right. It's not 45, it's 2 into 45 in the Mohr circle. So you need to rotate the AB 90 degree in the counterclockwise direction. So we obtain A dash and B dash. If you obtain the stress values at A dash and B dash and plot the stress state, you will obtain something like this. Note that this is A dash and this is B dash. In general, rotation theta in the coordinate system corresponds to 2 theta in the Mohr circle. Try to find the reason for this. And we have seen that B holds the maximum principal stress. So plane B is the principal plane, and the B dash holds the maximum shear stress. So plane B dash is the maximum shear stress plane. Let's quickly go through the torsion case as well. So of course the Mohr circle looks different from the previous case. Let us go through the insights. And we have this point that has the maximum principal stress, and this point has the maximum shear stress. We know that AB gives the stress state at theta equal to zero. Let's do the same exercise of finding the stress state at 45 degree. I'm going to rotate AB by an angle 90 degree. So we'll get A dash, B dash. And of course, A dash is this plane and B dash is this plane. If you obtain the stress values from the Mohr circle and plot the stress state, you'll get something like this. And the maximum shear stress plane corresponds to the plane B dash, and the principal plane corresponds to the plane A dash. So this is a note to read for yourself. I'm not going to explain this. And with that, I have completed the Mohr circle, and we are going to the final topic of failure theories. These are the failure specimens of the chalk from our experiment. Of course, I have shown them before. Although they look visually very different, do you think if there is anything common in them? The answer is yes, and failure theory provides that common link. The failure theories give a common condition of failure which are applicable for all loading states, and they are used for obtaining the load capacity of a structure subjected to complex loading states. We generally use three theories. The first one is the maximum principal stress theory, which are applicable for brittle materials, and the next ones are the maximum shear stress theory and maximum distortion energy theory, which are applicable for the ductile materials. Let's look into the maximum principal stress theory. The maximum principal stress theory states that the material will fail when the maximum principal stress reaches a critical value. The plane of failure is given by the plane corresponding to that of the maximum principal stress. Let's apply this to the chalk in tension. We have seen that plane B corresponds to the maximum principal stress, and hence this is the failure plane, and that's what exactly we see in the experiments. And for the chalk in torsion, we found that A dash is the principal plane, and hence this is the failure plane, and that's what we see in the experiments. With that, I have answered the first question. I'm not going to answer the next two questions because I have given enough background for you to answer these things, but I'll just quickly summarize this one. The bending will actually fail as tension. The ductile failure is a bit complicated, but you may try to apply the maximum shear stress and you may see what you got. And finally, thanks for listening, and leave your questions and feedback in the comment section.